I'm Mary Armanios. I'm trained as a cancer doctor, as you heard from Steve. And we've been interested in the consequences of telomere dysfunction and disease, and I hope to talk with you about that. And I think, as Carol introduced so nicely, this is a very timely moment in our field and how we talk about this biology in the public sphere and in terms of public health. So the title I have is one that I never expected when I went to medical school to have a title like this. And I think the title is loaded in terms of whether, how is our society thinking about aging and why anybody would ever think that there's a plausible yes to this question. But with that in mind, I think I will first talk about the health implications of telomeres and then how we can approach thinking about this advertising flood to the public, especially in the past few years. So when I came to Carol's lab, there was a lot in the press, and I think there still is, about telomeres and telomeres being the answer to everything. If they're too short, they cause aging, and if we can fix that, we can live forever. And telomerase is upregulated in cancer, and therefore targeting telomerase is going to fix all cancers. Both of those, I think, are not true, and I'll show you our reasoning for that. You heard from Carol about telomere shortening with age, and there being a very wide distribution. This is a first percentile and the 99th percentile, and over the last 10 years or so, we've been trying to study these folks who are on the very short end, and what is wrong with them, and thinking that if we can study them, we can really understand what is the contribution of telomere shortening to aging. And sorry for this busy slide, but it turns out that these patients have mutations. They are born with genetic defects in telomerase, the enzyme Carol discovered, and other related proteins. These are fairly rare. They occur; these mutations occur about 1 in 20,000 individuals in the population. We did not collect 100 of them by screening 2 million. We identified these individuals by virtue of recognizing that they have disease in our hospital. And the diseases they have, some of them are hidden by this sign, but they have two prominent kinds of diseases. One is this disease called bone marrow failure. It affects the integrity of stem cells in their blood, in their bone marrow, and the ability to make blood. And the other is a disease called IPF, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, which is far more common, and probably many of you might know someone who has this disease. So notably absent from this list is Alzheimer's, osteoporosis, and many of the common diseases that we're going to talk about. But these are nonetheless not that rare, as I hope to convince you. And the way that we became interested in this is through a fairly simple observation. A patient came to our hospital who was fairly young. He was a college student, and he went gray when he was 9 years old. He did not look otherwise prematurely aged. But in his family, all these diseases ran together, and it turned out that older individuals, like his grandmother, this is a pedigree of his family history, she developed and died from this lung disease, whereas he had the bone marrow failure problem. We recently have been working to understand, if not, and I will tell you up front, spoiler alert, it doesn't work to predict biological aging, can we use this medically? And one of the reasons this has been really important is because when the blood disappears, this is a picture of a bone marrow, the way that doctors diagnose bone marrow failure. And here's a normal, healthy bone marrow. All the purple spots are cells in our bone marrow that produce and make blood constantly. And in these patients with bone marrow failure, the blood disappears. But there's two different ways it can disappear. It can disappear by immune attack, or it can disappear by a clock mechanism failing in the stem cells in the blood. And we were able to show that we can distinguish these two modes of bone marrow failure by measuring telomere length in the blood. These are the folks that had the immune attack, and this is the shortening, the deviation from the median here. This is the distance of how short these patients are who have the stem cell failure. If you treat these patients with the same drugs as the ones with the immune attack, they die, actually. And we found in this study of about 40 patients that doctors were able to change their treatment in a quarter of the time based on this test. And this led to our development a few years ago to to figure out how can we make good data, good telomere length measurement available to the public. So we can use this to make decisions based on long or short telomeres in certain subsets of patients. And we reported these recently, and I want to just show you some highlights from that study. One of them is when we measured telomere length in healthy folks in Baltimore and compared them to a healthy control data set in Canada, we found that they were nearly identical, okay? You see here there's identical upper and lower boundaries of this, and I'll point that out why that's important. But as we look at the diseases caused by short telomeres, the disease that's actually far more common than bone marrow failure is this disease called pulmonary fibrosis, which is a distant cousin of a more common a problem in the lung called emphysema. And these patients develop progressive scarring in their lung, but I want to point out that this is a really understudied area because lung disease is the third leading cause of death in this country. And actually, if you think of hair graying as the manifestation of aging there, this scarring is the equivalent of what happens in the lung. It's the way the lung ages, and the telomere seems to be particularly prone to causing that problem. Now, there was a very large epidemiologic study published recently, not from our group, that included data from about 1.5 million people, and it was a really huge collaborative effort. And you can't see this, but these lines go to the right of one and to the left of one. To the right of one are the diseases that are caused by long telomeres, and to the left are the diseases that are caused by short telomeres. And if you look here, the disease, you might be able to see it from the back, that has the strongest effect size in this competition of 42 diseases is this disease called pulmonary fibrosis. It's peculiar. And you would think that if long telomeres are really good for you, as the advertising has been trying to claim and convince the public for I think commercial reasons, you would think that on the other end here should be longevity or health span or something that we would think is positive, but instead it's actually a very increased risk of cancer, especially cancer of the lung and cancer of the skin. So I think this really tempers the rhetoric and the conversation that the opposite of something we see with aging is really good and highlights what Carol tried to point out, which is that the middle is really ideal. So I want to just add a few words about this commercial testing. I think there are a few arguments that suggest it doesn't work. First, there is a flood of literature about the testing, the type of measurement that is used to offer the public telomere length testing to show that it is irreproducible. This is data from our group. The clinical measurement I showed you, if you do it on two different days or even across two different labs, it changes by 2%. Whereas the publicly available testing, the one that's $99.99 worth, changes by about a third, about almost 30%. And the telomere length distribution doesn't change by that much. So that is a problem, and that should be a conversation stopper in the public. And I've never seen anything in the scientific literature that has so much evidence of being irreproducible still being advertised. It's really remarkable. The other point is that there is a threshold, and Carol pointed this out in her talk, that there is a threshold in which we see disease. And that means that simple telomere shortening, which happens in all of us, is probably inconsequential. And there are probably many other factors that contribute to aging in a lot of the population, whereas in this subset of patients, it does contribute to disease. And that is a problem when you look at the type of testing. So unfortunately, as we have advanced in our ability to define and make available clinically meaningful testing to physicians and to their patients, there has been this flood, especially since this company reopened in the fall of 2016 and others like it, that have reached the public in very prominent ways, including the advertisements during the Super Bowl. This is a gentleman who lived in Baltimore, who lives in DC, and he's a lawyer actually, very well educated. And he called me and he said that he's decided to quit his job and sell his house based on the results of this direct-to-consumer testing. He's 39 years old, but this test told him that he was 80 years old. And when we measured it, he's well above the 10th percentile. From a clinical point of view, first of all, I wrote clinical here because we would have never measured the telomere length in him. And here, don't miss this point about what now, sorry, the quality is not good, because there's something, there's a product being sold here. There's a claim that there's something to fix this. So first of all, it's inconsequential, not correct. And moreover, there's a temptation to sell, and there is now a market, unfortunately, for this. Part of the problem with this has been that there are elements in the scientific field that have taken this fairly simple two-dimensional way of thinking about aging, right? This idea that there is a mitotic clock or a biological age that is somehow more valuable than some of the things that Ginny talked about recently, which is access to care. How can we care for the elderly? How can we have supportive environments? How can we engage people who are tired? To a focus that I feel is fairly superficial, and I hope to convince you of that today. Now, when these books came out early on, we've been talking about them, and they promote things like exercise and healthy eating. And on some level, those things are not harmful, and I think we'll hear the themes today that those things in and of themselves are good, for sure, right? But I do think that this type of conversation, especially when we talk about aging, especially when there are so many disparities, socioeconomic and otherwise, in the care for the elderly and in how we view aging psychologically, that make this a distraction. Moreover, the fact that long telomeres have a clear and well-documented cancer risk now is really alarming to me as a physician and suggests that this way of talking about things is not necessarily the best way. And the reason I'm sorry, pausing here, this is my last slide, is that I had this conversation with Dr. Blackburn, who's the author of this book recently, and she told me it's too late to fix this now. She agrees that the conversation has gotten out of hand. And I hope that today maybe we can think about trying to talk about these things in a new way, and maybe it's not too late. Maybe we can direct conversation and policy and a community effort around science and aging in a way that is a bit more nuanced. So I think with that I will stop and take questions with Carol. Yeah, thank you.